My name is Mark Danieli. I'm the director of Alamance County Cooperative Extension and also serve as the horticulture agent. So I work with homeowners that have gardening questions as well as a farmer.
All right, good morning. We had more folks sign up, but I think they got scared of the weather and stayed home, so that's okay too.
It took me about 5 minutes to get the diesel crank this morning.
Yeah, I'm sure that's true.
I didn't plug it up last night, so.
I'm sure. So we're going to spend a few minutes inside going through some slides, and then we'll actually go outside and do some pruning on some of our trees. Okay, here we go. All right, so we'll talk about pruning and training. So pruning is what we do this time of year, dormant pruning. But ideally, we'd prefer to minimize that. So we'd like to do some summer training, which people rarely do. So as a new growth comes out, we're trying to select and guide that new growth to where we want it, rather than having to do a lot of dormant pruning in the wintertime, which invigorates the plant and we're wasting a lot of wood. So we'll talk about that. So summer pruning, the main thing is it's going to reduce the amount of dormant pruning we have to do, because that's a very wasteful practice. So if we can select wood during the summertime, remove it then we don't have to take so much out in the wintertime. And I'll show you trees outside where we did not do our summer pruning and we should have, and you'll see what we have to cut out, which is not a good thing to do. Okay, the peach tree's there, so you got one on the left that was not summer pruned, one on the right it was, and you see how much more wood that's in this tree that was not pruned that has to be removed. And then that just makes the tree mad and it grows more the next year, and we're just wasting wood that could be made into productive wood, into flowers and fruit. So we want to try and do this summer pruning as best we can to avoid having so much dormant pruning in the wintertime. Okay, so the idea here is to control our tree size and shape. We don't really want to have a peach tree 14 feet tall. We don't really want an apple tree 20 feet tall. You just can't harvest, you can't prune, you can't spray, you just can't do these things with these trees that are out of shape. You want to have these things inside. And we're also trying to increase our light penetration to the interior. We don't really want to have all our fruit on the outside of the tree. We want to have fruit from the trunk out to maximize our production. We'll look at some pruning here in a minute. So we're trying to avoid having branches with this real sharp crotch angle. Those are gonna be very, very weak and probably gonna break under a load. We're trying to find an angle like this one here on the left. That's about a 60 degree angle. It's much less likely to break out than the sharp crotch angle. I'm gonna turn the light back on and show you a branch real fast, so we can see. So we've got the apple here, and so it was headed at this point. All this is last year's growth. The bud that comes out right below that is very sharp angle, and as we get further down, then these become a better angle. So this is a much better angle for scaffold branches. They're flatter, stronger, they won't break. So if we put a big load on this branch here and it breaks, it's going to break out here usually. That's not a big problem. So I can come back in here, prune that off, and I don't have such a big wound to deal with. This one right here, when this has a big load and breaks, it's most likely going to break down into the trunk. So we've got a bigger wound there. It's going to take much, much longer for that to heal up. So we're trying to avoid those real sharp branch angles. Okay, thank you. Okay, so that's the picture right there. So you know, this branch here would have come more straight up, and it's going to break into the trunk and be a bigger problem, where the branch angle at 60 degrees is going to break outside, and we can prune that off and not have such damage to our tree.
Do they have something you can spray on that, or wrap it? I've seen some programs where they wrap it in some kind of tape.
You could. So you could wrap it, but you're still going to have a big wound that has to heal over.
Yeah.
So you could wrap it
But ideally, you would not have a branch like that in there to cause that problem.
Okay. So we're trying to improve our structure so our trees don't break apart, ideally, because that's a problem. We want to have a better fruit quality, so if the light can get to the fruit, it's going to be better. And certainly going to reduce our disease problems because we have better airflow. So the tree can dry out faster in the morning, reduce the amount of fungal diseases that we might have. The two major training systems, so we've got central leader, apples and pecans, plums, open center for peaches and nectarines. We'll look at both of those, and you can grow them either way. So if you want to have an apple tree as open center, it's fine. If you want to grow a peach as a central leader, it's fine. You won't get the yield that you would otherwise, but if you want to grow them that way, you can do that. Okay, so where we have to start is at planting time. The trees need to be headed back, and people normally don't want to do that. They've got these trees that are 4 and 5 feet tall as a whip, and they need to be headed back usually at 30 to 34 inches. So waist high or so, because we're trying to start our scaffold branches down low, most people don't want to head back the trees, and they end up with scaffold branches starting at 5 feet or something, and your tree becomes too tall. So we want to head that off at 30 to 34, knowing that our scaffold branches will start probably 6 inches below where the head and cut is. All the branches up here that come out of those buds will be very upright. So we'll select one for a central leader, take the rest of them off. Scaffold branches be down at probably 28 inches or 26 inches to start with.
Can you do that, I mean, in the summertime? Like I say, I missed a couple of years and I've gotten kind of tall.
Ideally, you would do that now. So I really don't want you to go into 2 and 3 year old wood in the summertime.
Okay.
You can. You can. But if I had missed that, you could still do it now before the trees really leaf out.
Okay.
It would be better to go ahead and head them off at this point. Okay, so what we're looking for here is these B and C are very upright. We remove those. A is our new central leader. We've got our scaffold branches here, and we're trying to spread them out. So not only do we have branches going in all four directions around the trunk, we also want them spread out up and down the trunk. So we don't want to have two branches coming out from the same place because that makes the trunk weaker. So this will be a stronger tree to have these branches spread out up and down the trunk as well as all the way around the trunk.
Hey Mark?
Yes?
How would you straighten up A?
We're not really concerned about that. So over time, you know, it'll turn up. So it starts out kind of an angle, but it'll turn more vertical. So we don't really care if there's a little crook in the tree. It doesn't make that much difference. Okay. And then in the second year, we'll come back in here again. So we've already set our first set of scaffold branches. We'll come back up here 24 or 30 inches higher, cut it again to make our second set of scaffold branches, knowing that the first few buds will be very upright. One will be a central leader. Scaffold branches will be 6 or 8 inches below that cut. And we just keep doing that every year, just keep heading back that central leader, keep building those scaffold branches up to the height that we want to have our tree. Finish out.
Mark,
yes.
Question. Does all this apply to ornamental cherry trees as well?
It does not. So cherry trees you could do as a central leader or open center. It doesn't really matter. It depends on how you want to do that. So if it's going to be a central leader cherry tree, then you could. But for ornamentals, we don't care. You just let them go. Be fine. But if we were concerned about fruit production, and ornamental trees, it's just all about the flowers, so doesn't matter.
Okay.
You don't have the fruit load to break them apart, so they have some narrow crotch angles, not a big deal.
Okay.
All right, so our idea here is, you know, we're setting scaffold branches every 24, 30 inches. We're trying to keep the upper branches shorter, so light still gets to our lower scaffold branches. We're trying to have a light slot in there, so light can get to the inside of the tree to form flowers and fruit inside the tree. So we don't really want all our fruit on the outside because that reduces our yield. Plus, it could break the tree apart on the tips of those branches. Okay, so that's the top view there. So here's our central leader tree. Scaffold branches spread around. We've got nice side branches which will make fruit for us.
So still trying to have that one central leader there. Anything less than 60 degrees like this branch I showed you is very upright. We want to get rid of that because it's going to break down and could be a problem. We don't want the scaffold branches directly across from each other. We want them spaced up and down the stem so we don't have to worry about strength of our trunk. Okay, summer pruning really is going to be really, really important to avoid lots of whacking this time of year. So we'd have to do some pruning now, but if we had done a better job in the summertime, we wouldn't have to cut off so much. We wouldn't be losing so much wood that we'll lose here directly when we go outside. So we've got a new apple tree there. It's been headed at 30, 34 inches here. We're trying to set scaffold branches down below that cut. And you can see how these buds, when they break, the first few buds are very vigorous, very upright, and won't make good scaffold branches. Our scaffold branches will be down here at a much better angle. So we'll save one leader there for a new central leader, take off the rest of them down in here. So we've got a little central leader coming up here. Take those off, and these branches down below that will be at a better angle, and those could be scaffold branches that will keep on the tree permanently. Picture there is a plum. So we've got one central leader coming up, scaffold branches down 6 inches or so lower at a nice flat angle, where they'll make good, strong scaffold branches. And here's your apple tree there. So then the goal here is, as this new growth comes out this spring and early summer, we want to train it. So they're using toothpicks here to spread those branches down to try and get the proper angle. Not a good picture, but you can sort of see toothpick in there. And we're pushing those branches down, trying to get a flatter angle rather than one that's more upright. And you could use a weight if you wanted to. You could tie them down to the ground, but toothpicks work pretty well as long as the branch is not too big and woody. You can also use a clothespin. So a clothespin works very well. We put the clothespin on the stem and forces that branch to grow out instead of up. So as long as we're doing this early spring, when this is only a couple inches long, it's still good and soft and green, and it bends pretty well. If you wait until these branches get woody and hard, it's a little bit more difficult to spread them out. But when they're small and green, we can spread them pretty easy. So it's just a lot of strings. So they're tying down with strings, so that seems like that's just too much trouble.
Who's doing that?
Not me. I don't know who's doing that. But I'm not going to do that. So I'm using the clothespin method. It'll be a whole lot easier to handle, as long as the stem is not too big where you can't get the clothespin on it. Okay, and you can make these spreaders so as the branches get bigger and more woody. If you have to push them out, you can make spreaders like this that has a nail in the end, because the branches do want to try and grow up, but you may still have to push them down, so you can use that technique. What we're hoping for is to get a good fruit load on there and have the fruit pull the branches down is our ideal situation. Okay, so we're always trying to maintain that central leader to get the tree to the heights that we want. We're always going to be heading that back every year at 24 to 30 inches to set our new set of scaffolds for the following year. Some people have mature trees and have to be pruned, and that's very, very difficult to do. You know, this is an orchard where they've got old mature trees, and that's hard. I mean, you're up here in a tree with a chainsaw, and that's just not what we want to be doing. And while you can do that, that's not the way that I would want to go. It's very difficult to renovate an old tree like this. If you're going to do that, pretty much what you're going to do is come in here and take out probably one or more of these main trunks. You can't really get that back to a central leader. It's going to be an open center tree, and you want to avoid making a lot of cuts. The more cuts you make, the more you're going to encourage this very vigorous water sprout growth. So we cut up one or two main branches, but at this point, then my thought would be, why don't we just go ahead and plant a new tree? It's going to take you 3 years to get this back into any kind of shape at all. in 3 years' time, you could have a brand new tree in production that would be good for years and years, where this one here, you're always going to be fighting poor structure going forward. It may be better just to go ahead and just replace it. Same thing for these. You might could nurse them along for a little while, but you're just not going to have good production. It's going to be very hard to harvest off something that's 20 feet tall. I would say just go ahead and replace the tree and start over again. Okay, we do have all different kinds of training methods. So you could have a semi-dwarf tree like this MM111. The good news here, it doesn't require support. So it'll grow on its own. It's got a very strong root system, no problem there. And it's gonna be, you know, probably 14, 15 foot tall tree. You can get some of these dwarf trees, but all these dwarf trees require some kind of support. So whether it's a single conduit to tie them to, or some kind of a trellis system, they have to have support on those dwarf trees because the root system is not very vigorous and won't hold the tree up. So this is what we're going to more now, is this kind of a high density dwarf tree orchard. So instead of having 100 trees per acre of those big old trees, we're going to have probably 500 trees per acre of these dwarf trees. So they're going to top out at probably 8 foot tall. It'd be easy to pick, easy to prune, easy to spray. Our yield will be as good or better than those big trees. And it's just a whole lot nicer to work in an orchard like that. Okay. Any questions about the central leader?
Okay. Machines that can harvest that dwarf stuff yet? Or is that still hand stuff?
I imagine that's all still hand.
Yeah.
Right. But certainly harvesting this is easier than a 20-foot tall tree because you can just walk down the row and pick them as you go. So I don't know there is machinery that does that at this point. So we'll move on to the open center. So this is going to be our peaches and nectarines there. So we're still going to be heading this thing off at 30, 34 inches and trying to set our main scaffold branches in there, leaving the middle of the tree open. So again,
you don't want more than five.
So anywhere from 3 to 5. So head them off again, 30, 34 inches. And this will be different from what our central leader, so we're trying to grow a new leader there. These we're not going to. So our problem is, you go to buy a peach tree, this peach tree we saw several years ago, and this thing is 8 foot tall. Well, it needs to be headed at 30 inches. Most people don't want to do that. They don't want to cut off two-thirds of the tree they just bought, but we really need to set those scaffold branches down fairly low so we end up with an 8 foot, 10 foot tall peach tree versus something that's 14 feet tall where you just can't maintain. So they really need to be headed off at 30, 34 inches. Then as these new branches start coming out, that's where we're going to train them. We'll pick the ones we want for new scaffolds, and we'll try to get the right angle on these branches. Should have a picture. So there's, you know, a peach tree that's 6 foot tall. Again, we've got to cut that back. So we'll cut it back here anywhere from 30 to 34 inches to start forming those scaffold branches. So we're going to cut it off somewhere in that neighborhood, and then these lower branches in here will be our scaffold, so there won't be a central leader on this tree at all. It'll be always open. Yes?
Could you back, if you noticed that those side branches, the scaffold branches, didn't seem to have enough life in them, or was it, would you cut them at the end and then force
them? So depending on what they are, so if, you know, if they're too big or too small, we would cut them off completely back to the trunk and grow a new scaffold branch.
But if you didn't like what you were seeing, if you wanted to encourage it to bud more?
So if it's a good branch that we're going to keep, then we are going to head it off. So we'll come out here 18, 24 inches and head that off to try to force some side branching on it too. Okay, so it's been headed off now. We've got some scaffold branches that are left, and we want to kind of look down from the top and say we got about 6. Well, we know this one here is underneath that one, so that branch will be shaded out, so we'll almost certainly will take that one off. And we may stay with 5 because they're pretty well spaced around the trunk got a little bit of concern about this one being so big. So it is bigger than what we really want, so we may have to head that off. We may take that off just depending on how it looks out there in the field.
That's just to keep it, the tree from getting too
well,
heavy on one side
balanced.
Or
yeah, so a branch like this, when, if it gets to be more than like a third the diameter of the trunk, it's going to take a lot of vigor out of the tree at the expense of the other branches. So we could head it back and it may be okay, but we may have to remove it depending on how it grows. So if it gets too vigorous, we may take it off and start a new scaffold branch. Okay, so then, you know, after the first year, then we're going to select these scaffolds and then we're going to head them back. So any of these scaffolds, once they get out here to 18, 24 inches, we're going to head them. We're trying to make those scaffolds branch again to fill out our bowl. So the open center tree will be basically a bowl open in the middle, and any branches that are coming down will be taken off because they'll get shaded out. And we'll see that outside in just a minute. Okay, so we had the tree before pruning, so we've got to get in there and get all this interior wood out because we really want to have that center opened up. So anything that's a vigorous upright shoot will be removed. Ideally, we would have done this in the summertime. As these shoots got to be 4 or 5 inches long, take them off then instead of having to remove this big chunk of wood, where that growth could have been directed toward more productive wood that we could be saving for the next year. So ideally, we wouldn't do that this time of year. We should have done it in the summertime. As you got these branches that are very vigorous going upright, we'll head them back to a side branch. We're trying to control the height and control the vigor of the tree. And we'll do that outside. We'll head some of these things back to try and keep these things under control. So we've taken out a lot of wood there. You know, ideally, a lot of that would have happened in the summertime, so we're not doing so much dormant pruning, but you can do that, and we will. Fruit thinning, so we'll talk about fruit thinning. We talked about freeze. So we know for peaches, if we have 80 or 85% of our blossom saved, we still have a full crop, so we're okay, possibly. But what we need to look at here is this kind of situation on the peach tree. Right.
It was 2 slides ago. And then you mean you were just going to, no, there you go.
Here, right. So this, so we've got this shoot that's coming up here.
You're just going
to
cut it out.
Going to take it out completely to this branch that's coming out a little bit more to the side. Right, so we're trying to spread the tree out and open it up.
Okay.
Right. So we're talking about the fruit thinning, so we know we don't need all of these blossoms. So this one here has got 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16. You know, maybe up to as many as 20 peaches could be set on this stem, and we know we can't hold 20 peaches on this stem, each one weighing 1/2 pound. So we want to thin them down. We'll start where this branch is attached to the stem, and we'll pick 1, 2, 3. We might leave 4 on here. We may only go to 3 because there's so many on there we just can't.
You're talking about actually clipping the blossoms.
What we'll do is we'll wait till the fruit's formed. Right, because we don't know what we're going to have. So we'll wait till the fruit's like marble size or something, and then we'll go back through there and then thin them. We won't thin the flowers now because we don't know at this point what we're going to make. And you compare this to our apple branch. The only flower bud here is at the very tip. And where people get in trouble is they go out there to prune their apple tree. So you look at this one here, flower bud. We had there's no buds here, no buds there. The only buds on these two branches are right here. So people go out there and say, okay, well, I'm going to prune my apple tree. Let's head this back. Head back up. You just cut your flowers off, so there'll be no fruit here. It's okay, you can head back a peach all you want to because we've got flowers all up and down the stem. with apple tree, it's going to be on the terminals and maybe on some spurs. So if you head back your apple tree kind of willy-nilly, you just cut all your fruit off. Okay. We're trying to avoid that. People will have peach trees and they're trying to prop these branches up with 2x4s and whatnot, but that's not the goal. The goal is to thin the fruit so that what remains would be nice, big, healthy fruit rather than having a bunch of little golf ball size things on there. And we won't have to worry about our tree breaking apart and our fruit will just be much, much better. Commercially, they do this thinning with a softball bat. They just beat the fruit off the trees. And this fruit probably is anywhere from marble size to maybe ping pong ball size when they go to thinning. So we know at this point in time, we're probably in May. We've got a fruit set we can depend on, but we have to thin it down to the point where there's enough fruit there to make a crop, but not so much to break the tree apart. Same thing with apples. So apples are a multiple bloom. So we'll have 4, 5, 6 flowers per cluster. And we really need to thin them down to just one apple per cluster because that'll make a bigger apple. We'll have less disease problems and less chance of the tree falling apart.
And that cluster is only going to be on the tip of
the... On the tip, or on the spurs. And we'll look at the apple tree outside and I can show you.
5 or 6 tips and it started to actually produce fruit that year. You're only going to have 5 or 6 apples.
5 or 6 clusters.
Clusters, and right. You're going
to trim. And you would thin them down to one. Each. Right, right.
Okay.
Thin them down to one. But still, again, we wouldn't do this until we know we've got a fruit set. And then we start thinning at that point in time. We don't want to thin flowers because we don't know what's going to happen eventually. And here's the thing with apples. That wouldn't prune very well. So, you know, you put some apples on this big branch. There's nothing in here at all until you get to the very end. And we've got really a bad structure of a tree. And what happens with a big crop load on apple trees, they become biennial barren. So these apples that are on the tree suppress flower formation for the next year. So you'll have very few flowers next year. So a heavy crop of apples this year, very few the next year. That's another reason why we want to thin them. Not a problem on peaches. We'll always have peaches subject to freeze. But the apples, a real heavy crop this year, will prevent them from having a good crop next year. So thin them down, it'll make a better fruit and less likely to be in this biennial barren situation. Okay, so I would say we can go outside, put on your jacket, and we'll prune a few trees. So here's our peach tree. We did not do any summer pruning on this last year, so we have a lot of these real vigorous upright shoots that shouldn't be there. So pretty much anything that's going up or down would go away. We're gonna sort of hedge our bets this year since we don't know what we're gonna have fruit-wise. So we can pretty well guess any open blossoms have been killed. These blossoms that had not opened yet, we've got a chance of saving some of those. So instead of removing this entire stem, which you normally would, we're not going to do that. Instead of that, I'm going to head it off something like this and to see if we can salvage some fruit on those buds that are still fairly tight. So we'll sort of take the recommendation with a little grain of salt and take these that are still have some fairly tight buds on them. We may can still make some fruit on some of these, so we won't remove as much as what you normally would. You got this big branch in there. See, that should really come out. But we've got some buds in here that are still fairly tight. They might make a peach for us. So instead of taking out this whole thing, I'm gonna just take out the top part, head it back some. This stem has got a few fairly tight buds on it, head that back some. So our pruning now will be a little bit more conservative than what we normally would do, trying to maintain possibly having some fruit this year. Yes. Yeah, right. So if there wasn't a freeze, yeah, that whole thing would go away. We really don't want anything going up, but since we're not too sure what's going to happen, We're going to leave a little extra wood that we normally would not.
We're talking about, like, to make sure we're not going to get another freeze, would we be better off waiting 3 more weeks, 4 more weeks to do that?
We'll probably go ahead and do a light pruning now, and then we'll come back. So we'll look at these. So we want to control the height here. So we know we don't want these to continue going up. They're just going to be too tall in any case. So anything above 6 or 7 feet, I'm going to head off regardless, because I just don't want this tree to get out of hand. And then my branch here is getting too far out from the trunk of the tree. If I put a lot of peaches on this out here, I'm probably going to break that branch over. So I'm going to go ahead and head this back to a side growing branch somewhere like that. And then go ahead and head off these other tall growing shoots to try and get my height down. And I can come through here and it's not a problem at all. If I want to head back some of these, it's fine, because all of our fruit are up and down the stem. It's not like the apple where the bud's just on the tip. So I can head back any of these I want to. I can come in here and go, okay, this is way too thick. Start thinning out some of these. So we've got more air circulation inside the tree. But again, some of these branches that I would normally take off, I'm not going to take off, just to leave us a chance of making some fruit. And I can come back, say, middle of April, and once we have got a fruit rut on here, and thin out.
Would be the time when you could tell if it was a peach or not?
Yeah, mid to end of April, depending on what our weather's like. But branches are coming down like this. We don't really want to have those in there. We'd get those off. Right.
And you would just come in, say, July?
You'll start in May. So as a new growth is coming out, so you kind of see, you see this long sprout here. So that's all last year's growth. What we should have done as this was coming out, because we may use this for a new scaffold branch to kind of fill in a gap here. What we should have done last summer, early spring, late spring, was as this was coming out, we had no branches until we got out of here about 3 feet. This really should have been headed off probably somewhere in there last spring and summer. So instead of losing all this growth this time of year, this growth would have been directed out into branches, and probably all we would have had done this time of year is just head off the tip of it, and then all this branching would have been down closer to the trunk. We just lost all that growth there. We've got several inside here. You see these sprout there, sprout there. All this stuff on the interior of the tree should have been cut out last spring and summer, so we don't have to lose all this growth. That growth could have been directed to something more permanent. But I didn't do it. So we still just keep on heading stuff, some of the stuff back. We're not gonna cut it back as much as we should. We do wanna get the center open as best we can. Try and have light air penetration into the center of the tree. Let me get around this way. Yeah. This is Carolina Gold. So really anything in the center would come out. So we got these branches in here. So ideally, this branch here, that's all last year's wood. We should have headed this back probably to 6 or 8 inches and made some branches on it. I'm not gonna take it out completely, even though I probably should. I'm gonna head it back some because it still has some fairly tight buds on it. So there's a chance we might can make some fruit there. But ideally, anything comes to the inside would be cut off in order to get better airflow through the tree and light to the fruit. But I'm kind of hedging my bets. We don't know what's going to happen. So I really could go back through here and thin it out a lot more, but I'm gonna wait because we don't know what's gonna happen. I'm gonna cut this out here. So this has gotten to be way too tall and it's way too long. So I'm gonna cut this out. And anything that's like this is coming out too long, I'm gonna head these off as well to avoid this getting too far out. These branches are coming down below, so they're gonna get shaded out. Anything that's going below gets removed. And then head back everything else that we'll keep for the time being. Okay. So I could pick on this a whole lot more, but we'll go ahead and move on to the apples. Because still we don't know what we're going to have here as far as fruit-wise, so I do need to go around, head back to all the tall shoots, clean out the center some more, thin back some more branches, but we'll let that wait until we see what we're going to end up with after the next couple weeks. Okay, apple tree. Right, right. So here, we're trying to go for central leader. We've got a set of scaffold branches there, set of scaffold branches there. We're trying to make a new set of scaffold branches here. Tree's not cooperating very well, so they don't really have anything on this side coming out very well. But you can see the flower buds. So this tree is a spur type. So we have flowers on the tips. We also have flowers on these little spurs starting to open up. So we've got to be real careful about how we prune this tree. As you look at this stem here, the flower's just on the tip up there. Flower's just on the tip. So all of these shoots here, the flowers are just on the tips. So if we go back in there and head those off, then we're not gonna have any fruit on this branch at all. So I'm not gonna head those to take a chance on getting some fruit. You can see here, we had a fire blight strike last year. We got a canker. I'm gonna try and cut that off down below that canker. Hopefully we won't have that fire blight spread anymore. But I'm gonna leave those two, even though they should have been headed actually last summer. If I come in here somewhere, I could have headed those off, made some side branches, and probably had, you know, six different flower buds. But since I did not head that off, it just grew straight up and set one flower bud on the very tip. So that should have been headed last summer, but I didn't do that. Same thing for this branch here. One flower bud on the very tip. That should have been headed back in here over summertime, and I would have had more branches and more flower buds.
Now, does this look the way it should, except these are a little bit too long? Does this look?
Yes.
Because you've got.
Yeah, except for this one. That one should have been headed back. Last year, which I didn't do.
But this was cut out, and so you've got
right.
Some.
So we do have some branches there, so we have some flowers here. Right, those should have been headed back as well during the growing season. But we've had a fire blight strike there. We've had a fire blight on this tree pretty bad. So we won't cut it back quite as hard because we don't know what's going to live and what's going to die. And this is a pretty good branch here. So we've got a lot of flower buds there, but we'll have to thin those. But that's not bad. Had a big fire blight strike here. Canker's come all the way down. So really, we just need to go ahead and just take that whole stem out, even though we do have a couple of stems that may make a flower. We don't really want to have that fire blight in the tree, so we're trying to cut back the good, healthy wood there. We don't really have a good third set of scaffolds, and so you could, at this point in time, you got a choice. We could come back in here and head this off again and try to get those scaffolds to fill out instead of being so lopsided like it is at this point in time. So what I'm hoping is head that back this year, we'll get some more buds to break and trying to fill out this over here. I'm gonna go ahead and head these back to try and reduce this growth. So I do have a few flowers there on those spurs, so I'm not losing a lot. I got a few flowers there, so I can take that off. And I got a couple flowers there, so that's not too bad either. I could head that back. So still maintaining a few little flowers there and trying to encourage some branching coming out in that direction to fill out that third scaffold. But all these long shoots here should have been headed back during spring and summer. You see how vigorous this branch is. And it's all this. That 4 foot is all last year's growth. And you got, you know, one flower on the very tip.
That's not the idea.
Right. Yeah. So ideally, that should have been headed back somewhere in here last summer.
So you'd have more of this.
Right, force it to branch rather than let it go straight up. Now what we can do is just leave it alone, since we may have a flower up there, and hopefully what will happen is if we put an apple on that, the apple will pull this branch over, and when that does that, then it should grow some new branches along the stem in here. If it does, then we can come back the following winter, head this back to these side branches and have some fruit on those. So all of these, well, they should be headed off. I'm gonna hope for fruit on them. If not, I may take a weight and pull them down to try and make them branch instead of heading. So we're kind of hedging our bets again, hoping for fruit. If not, we'll pull them down and see if we can't make some branches in here. We really don't want to have this situation where we got, you know, 4 foot of new growth and one flower on the very top. We'd rather have more branching like this where we've got fruit on spurs. And these are not bad, and ideally you'd have more branching than this, but we could put maybe a fruit on there, a fruit on there, a fruit on there. That's possible. We do have a little issue here. These branches are crossing over, so I am going to head that one off just to keep from having these crossing branches rubbing together. That's not great, but we can live with that. So still, like the peach, we're gonna wait and see. Well, we could do some more thinning. Probably some of these upright branches should go away, but we're gonna wait and see what makes fruit. If it makes fruit, fine. If it doesn't, we can always come back in here and whack these off some more. But all of these, again, should have been headed last summer to force them to branch and make some more fruiting spurs instead of just having just this one flower on the very tip of all these branches. Questions about that? Yes. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, it really should have been headed out. Yes, ma'am? Yeah, the ideal situation here actually would be just take this branch out, because we've got branches there and there, and it's kind of low. So in the big picture, that would go away. Yeah, that probably should go away too. Yeah, that's fine. So really, we really could thin it out a whole lot more. But again, we don't know what's gonna happen with the freeze. We don't wanna cut back too much. We'll wait and see if it sets some fruit. And we always could come back after the fact and thin it out some more, because it really is, in a lot of cases, is too thick and could use some more heading back. Other questions? We're good? We'll head back inside. Where's Horn? Has questions? Nope. Got it? I'm done. You're done. You're welcome.
Okay, so we have gardening classes, usually about two per month. So I think Green Thursday's class schedule. All different kinds of gardening topics. So we've done pruning. We'll have a class on vegetable gardening. We'll have a class on birds. We have a rain garden class, drought-tolerant plants, fall lawn care. It's quite a long list gardening classes we provide to the public to give them a better understanding of different gardening topics. All our classes are free, and they're held at 10 o'clock on Thursday morning here in the Ag Building.